So then I spent about 2 hours in the house. A young girl came. She showed up from the back. And he approached her. He grabbed her by the arm. And she asked her to say hi to me. I said hi to her, but she never said hi to me. And then he said that was his granddaughter.
Was there anything else that you kind of noticed when you were in the house?
There was some type of, like, noises that I hear. I don't really know exactly where the noises came from. And I asked him, what is this noises coming from? And he said that he had some dogs in the second level of the house, second floor.
Knowing what you know now, knowing what you might have heard, what those noises might have been, how does that make you feel?
When I heard the news at first, they came out on Monday, I couldn't even believe. I went home and started looking at the news, really deep into the news. And when I saw it was him, I saw the pictures, I could not believe I was just inside the house.
The little girl Ricky spoke to is not Castro's granddaughter. She's his daughter, Jocelyn. On Christmas Day 2006, Amanda Berry, aged 20, gives birth to her in a paddling pool in the basement. Michelle Knight is put in charge of the delivery. She says Castro threatens to kill her if the baby dies. Michelle keeps the baby alive with mouth-to-mouth resuscitation. One of Castro's older daughters recalls seeing a picture.
He showed me a picture that was in his cell phone randomly, and he said, look at this cute little girl. It was a face shot, and I said, she's cute, who is that? You know, and he said, this is my girlfriend's child. And I said, Dad, that girl looks like Emily. Emily's my younger sister. And he said, no, that's not my child. That's my girlfriend's child by somebody else.
Cleveland, June 2008. The moment when the local police did catch up with Ariel Castro.
See your driver's license. See your driver's license, please. What's wrong? First off, your plate's improperly displayed. It has to be displayed left or right, not upside down.
Arresting officer Jim Simone doesn't know it, but Castro has already kidnapped three girls and is holding them captive in his house.
They have to be able to read them from behind.
I stopped him on a traffic violation in June of 2008.
I just got it out, so.
It's your motorcycle endorsement.
That I don't have.
Then the other question is, why are you riding it then?
Sir,
you don't have a helmet on, you don't have a license to operate it, and you subject yourself to being arrested. Is that what you want?
No, sir, I don't.
I just stand by your bike. Take out your insurance document.
He didn't have a license. He didn't have, the plates were not belonged, did not belong to that particular motorcycle. Normally, I would have arrested him had he given me any back talk. Had he been flippant with me or made some remark, I'd have slipped the cuffs on him and took him to jail.
Ariel, you keep getting deeper, deeper, and deeper.
I know, but I just got off of work. I'm a school bus driver, and I was going to get this all taken care of. I thought that was crazy.
He mentioned the fact that he was a school bus driver. And I didn't want to take him to jail and have a possibly him losing his job because of a traffic violation.
You got to get the plates changed over. You got to get all the things that are required by law. This is an arrestable violation. You could be going to jail over something silly. You know?
So I didn't arrest him. I gave him a ticket and let him push the bike home. Because I did a check on him. All these cars are equipped with computers. I'm able to do a background check on anybody. And he only had a few traffic violations and no criminal background. So with that, I gave him the tickets and let him go. I made 10,000 arrests as a policeman. That's not traffic tickets. That's 10,000 people I put handcuffs on and threw in the back of his car and took him to jail. So there are times when you're amazed how bad it gets.
Jim has been a Cleveland cop for 38 years, 18 patrolling the 2nd District, which includes Seymour Avenue.
I went past this house 1,000 times. Nothing at that house drew my attention, even with the crime scene tape around it. It was just a house on Seymour. Yet in that house, there was a heinous crime being committed every second of every day for 10 years.
But while police incompetence features highly in many of America's most notorious kidnap cases, the failure to find Castro and the Cleveland captives may be down to something else. The missing persons database kept by the Cleveland Police Department has over 100 names on it as of last week, with nearly half of them missing all year. When you look at this list of names, you get a sense of how swamped the police here are. Do they have the resources to cope? In the second district alone, which is where Castro's house is, 71 people are missing right now. The number of detectives assigned to work on cases of missing people is one.
Do you feel like the police have done a good job?
No, I think that they could have done a better job of what they was doing, especially for her.
Do you feel there's enough resources at the police's disposal to successfully look for these kids that go missing?
No. No, there's not. Because we handle a realm of things. It's not just the missing person. It's the auto theft. It's the burglary. It's the rape. It's the B&E. It's the shooting, the homicide. So in reality, you know, even though the chief may want to contradict me later on, we're stretched thin. You don't have the man hours to invest in a major investigation, because when I was a young policeman, it was about catching the bad guy. Today, it's how much is it going to cost us to catch the bad guy. And if it costs too much, then it's set aside. And what happens, they make the initial investigation, and then we wait. We wait for either the body to be found, or in this case, for some amazing rescue.
Members of the community who still want to know what happened to her.
Just 2 weeks before the amazing rescue, local TV marks the 10th anniversary of Amanda Berry's disappearance. No one knows she's alive and in a house just a few miles away.
The vigil just breaking up in the last, say, 5 minutes, and those who were in attendance today want everyone around here and everyone around the city to know it's never too late to do the right thing, and no tip, no clue is too small.
The clue is provided by Ariel Castro himself. He's gone out, but hasn't chained up all of his captives. Finally, he's made a mistake.
Was he good or what? What kind of person would do something like that?
You know.
Well, he slept.
Amanda Berry can see the front door open, though the outer storm door made of thin wire mesh is bolted shut. Often Castro will test his captives by leaving doors unlocked. He beats them if they try to get out. But because Amanda can see Aurora Marty on the neighbor's porch opposite, she goes for it.
Help me, I'm Amanda Berry.
You need police, fire, or ambulance?
I need police.
Okay, and what's going on there?
I've been kidnapped and I've been missing for 10 years and I'm here, I'm free now.
On a day that will long be remembered, Charles Ramsey's account of the breakout makes him an instant internet legend.
See the sunlight to be around people.
I knew something was wrong when a little pretty white girl ran into a black man's arms. Something is wrong here. Dead giveaway.
From Seymour Avenue, ambulances rush Michelle, Amanda and Gina and the child to the local hospital. Gerald Maloney is the admitting doctor.
You were in charge of their care for
these. They came in by ambulance, and there was also a lot of law enforcement officers, both local police and FBI, with them as well at that point. So it's fairly chaotic when everybody came in initially. There were a lot of people here. There was a lot of energy, good energy.
So where were the girls taken immediately when they arrived?
They were brought into the two rooms behind us.
Would it be possible to have a look?
Absolutely.
Thank you.
It's the first time any cameras have been allowed into the rooms where Amanda, Michelle and Gina were examined.
We did a detailed exam. You know, we checked their head, neck, body, extremities, you know, looking for any injuries or any acute medical issues. Too often, unfortunately, we hear about an end to these stories. The end we hear isn't people being found and being alive. It's usually, unfortunately, finding remains. So we were very excited that they were here, they were alive, and we were very excited that we got to be the first safe harbor for them after they've been rescued.
Nurse Betsy Martinez is a neighbor of the De Jesus family and has a daughter the same age as Gina. She's on duty on May the 6th and is just about to have dinner when her boss breaks the news that will live with her forever.
They found Amanda Berry and Gina De Jesus, and I could not understand what, I didn't believe it. Like, excuse, like who? I kept saying, who? He kept saying Amanda Berry, Georgina De Jesus.